Warning. This podcast may contain spoilers from whatever TV show or movie is mentioned. Please listen at your own discretion. Welcome to Viewers Anonymous.
What's going on? I am Scoops Bronson.
And I am S. Foster.
And you tuned in to another episode of the Viewers Anonymous podcast, where we give you takes and reviews of TVs and movies straight out of Hollywood. What's going on with you, my boy?
Man, can't call it, man. Very, very, very slow motion. But, you know, I find a way to get up for it, man. Because, like, these right here, like I was telling you when we was doing our little post or whatever, really just catching up and shit. And we call it post-production, but, like, we really just be fucking tripping and just start the fucking pod.
For sure.
But yeah, like, I was talking before then about – damn, now I forgot what I was going to say. But yeah, well, good, bro, man. How you feeling, man? Everything,
man,
good?
Man, I'm on cloud nine, man. I have been, you know what I'm saying, jumping into this Twitch thing, and it's been fun as heck. I've been getting stuff together, bro. You know what I'm saying? About to get my little space together to get my background right. So yeah, man, just focusing on that for the time being, you know what I'm saying? Continuing to find other avenues to create and do all that good stuff. So I'm enjoying life, man.
That's what's up, man. Always glad to hear that.
Got to,
even if it's a lot of chaos around you, man, you got to find a way to enjoy life, man.
Oh yeah, man, for sure, man. Especially with today, man, I ripped my drawers. So, you know what I'm saying? That's nothing but chaos, bro. And it was raining all day today, which was wild. I was so tired, bro.
But you just don't understand. But that's today was one of those days where, like, especially FedEx, UPS, Amazon, Postal Service, where we like, fuck this shit. Mm-hmm. Like, it was, I mean, constant all day.
Chucking
the That's man. All it did was rain all day. And then the thing about here is that it rained all day, but it's still 64, 65 degrees. So it's too warm for a rain jacket.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So I had on shorts and, like, you know those rain shirt type things, the short sleeve, like baseball players were wearing shit?
Yeah.
Yeah, I got one of those, and I had somebody, like, engraved, like, the FedEx ground joint on there.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so it's just like, man, I just threw that bad boy on this morning in my FedEx hat.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, you know, you just got to take that rain, man. You just got to take it. Just like one of them days where you're like, boy, I wish I could call in on these motherfuckers.
Man, me and you both, they would definitely make us work in the rain if it was anything short of us getting electrocuted. Because, you know what I'm saying, we got to use power tools and shit. But yeah, if they could find a way to make us work in the rain, they damn sure would. I remember they had like two dudes that worked with us working out in the snow one time. I'm like, man, these niggas. So they really don't care about us for real. They just want to make sure everything gets done. Yeah, it's reckless, bro. It's reckless. I mean, they do cool stuff for us here and there, but for the most part, if something got to get done, bro, you might as well just get ready because they definitely going to put you away.
Nah, I feel you though. We be feeling the same way. Like, we be having like little, like they be shooting us texts, you know, saying, you know, be careful out there, you know, nah, nah. And you be like, are y'all really telling me to be careful because y'all just don't want me to wreck this damn truck?
Yeah, I bet you that's for liability purposes.
Yeah, it's like, y'all just don't want me to wreck the truck. But yeah, man, I hate to hear that you ripped your drawers, man. You know what I'm saying?
Me too, man. Shit, it was a good pair, man. You know what I'm saying? That's be like that though, man.
Oh man, he said that was a good pair.
Yeah, bro.
That's funny.
So you
that's
know,
funny.
It is what it is, man. You know, you can't be too mad. I got a great laugh out of it though. You know what I'm saying? It kind of made the day go past a little faster because I'm the only one who knows. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, oh, so I'm laughing to myself all day, like. Man, this can't be life.
And you probably was walking funny and didn't even like realize it.
Not every now and then I was, you know what I'm saying? Because like it's a, like the because I ripped it, it's a string back there. So I'm trying to like moving stream. I'm like, man, crazy, bro. Like I told you, bro, I was at work free balling with drawers on, man.
Oh man, that is funny.
It was wild, man. But man, this is gonna be a very exciting episode, man. Like we told you guys on the coming soon of the last episode, this one is great for so many reasons, mainly because of the nostalgia of it all. But yeah, before we do that though, we gotta get into our favorite our favorite topic, our favorite subject, I mean favorite segment. Said the same thing in different ways. We getting into what we watching, man. Let's do this thing.
Let's do it.
What we watching? What we watching?
All right, man. So what do you got this week?
So, man, I got two this week, man.
Okay.
I was able to get a lot of content in this week. Wasn't such a busy week like last week was. I wasn't able to get a lot of content in. But so both of them are Netflix. One is a doc and one is a movie. I go to the movie first. And I heard someone speaking about this movie before. And they were just saying that, you know, if you are a person that, you know, not good with taking trauma, don't watch this type of thing. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, that's a very intriguing thing to say. So let me check it out. And plus, the main person that sent it is Mina Kuntz. So, you know. But for the movie that I watched, man, I watched The Luckiest Girl Alive. And, like, basically, with this movie, that's the wrong thing. But that's all good, though.
That's the book cover.
Yeah, that's the book cover. But it's all tied into
Nah,
it.
That's the movie poster.
That's not Mina, man.
That is her.
No, it's not.
It said her name at the bottom, man.
Do it.
Yeah.
Oh, it does. Oh, well, anyway. So basically what this movie was about was so she, when she was in high school, right?
Mm-hmm.
She was at school during a school shooting. And the people that shot the school up was actually two of her friends. And like within that, the whole like when she finally like told like the story of like what really happened, she was the one who like she was like one of the reasons why they even done it in the first place. Because like people used to pick on her and shit like that.
Yeah.
But like within people picking on her, like they would pick on them because, like, they was, like, you know, quote-unquote considered, like, geeks or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know what I'm saying? They came to school. One came with a shotgun. One came with a, you know what I'm saying, with, like, a AK-47. So they, like, shooting up the school. And, like, and they're not just shooting random people. Like, they shooting people they really...
The people who...
Yeah, exactly.
Oh,
and
wow.
So she was, like, there during the time. And then, like, one of the dudes, she ended up, like, he gave her the gun.
Mm-hmm.
And was like, you know, come on, like, let's go do this or whatever, whatnot. And then she ended up, like when he turned around, she ended up, like, putting the gun down, like, stabbing him in the neck. So, like, she killed him.
Wow.
And I forgot if she killed, I can't remember if she killed, no, she didn't kill the other guy. But within that, one of the reasons why it wasn't just that they was picking on her, she got raped.
Mm-hmm.
By like three dudes at a party. It was two dudes, it's either two or three dudes at a party, and she got raped. So that was another reason, because the one guy, he was just like, yo, like, you know he raped you. And when the teachers and them ask you, you know, you just kind of brush it off or whatever, whatnot. So like when all this stuff came up, like she's a grown adult and she's like about to get married to this guy, but this guy has no idea like about that part of her past.
Wow. But
she changed her name.
Okay.
And but like there's different scenes where like she had like trauma and shit where she'll just like black out and just fucking go nuts for, you know what I'm saying, for a scene or whatever, whatnot. But I mean it was a pretty good movie. I mean, it wasn't the greatest movie that I've seen, but I mean it's a pretty good movie. But like I see what the person meant, because as far as like if you have a problem with watching, you know, somebody dealing with trauma and actually, you know, playing out a situation where, especially the time that we're in now, like mm-hmm. there's like a school. I mean, how many school shootings have we had this year already?
Yeah.
So to actually have that on screen, like I'm pretty sure there are kids who have been in a school during a mm-hmm. school shooting. They probably shouldn't watch this movie.
Okay. Okay.
They really should out,
because this will sound like one of the ones.
Yeah. Yeah. Like it's good. It's a really good movie. So shout out to the people that did that. And the other movie, well, no, the documentary that I watched, 3-part limited series, also on Netflix. I watched Killer Sally. And this was something that you brought to my attention. Like, I yeah. remember seeing, like, I watched, like, the trailer when it came across. That's mm-hmm. You know, that's something that's kind of fun to do sometimes, is just sit back and just, like, just click over on Netflix and just let all the trailers yeah. play. Like, that's
you never know. You never know what'll pop up.
Exactly. And like sometimes like you probably wasn't interested by the cover, and then mm-hmm. like the trailer played, you'd be like, you know what, that's all right. So I had seen the trailer, but then you mentioned to me like, yo, you need to watch Killer Sally. So I'm not gonna go long on it, but in this situation, I think that two things can be true. I think that if y'all haven't seen this or plan on seeing it, whatever. I think that her husband Ray, I believe that he was beating her,
mm-hmm.
but I'm not like, I think that it wasn't a situation where she was just taking beatings at the same right. time, because I mean, if you're watching this, y'all see Sally's not a small
that's,
girl. Like,
that's why I like, told you, man, I think one of them times she could have took dude, bro.
Like, I think that they were, you know, they were fighting, but obviously with both of them being bodybuilders, like, I mean, mm-hmm. Ray, he was a big guy, man. Like,
yeah.
I mean, don't get me wrong, like, especially for a woman, like, she was big too. And then I like how they got into the whole thing of, like, women bodybuilders, like, when they first, like, really, really mm-hmm. started getting buff. And then they were talking about how the money differences and shit like that. And they got into, like, her background.
Can we get into the fact that she was doing fetish porn?
Yo, the crazy thing about that, dude, because you said you got, I don't know how far you got, but like, dude, when they set her bond mm-hmm. at 100,000,
yeah,
and like all those guys that she was doing the fetish wrestling with bailed her ass out.
Yes.
Like they all came together and bailed her out.
So she was getting paid to wrestle dudes.
Like
that's what that's okay, because I don't want to be disrespectful and I don't want to shame nobody. So I'm not gonna say it's weird. That's very peculiar of somebody to want to get wrestled by a muscular woman.
I'm with you on the fact of like, because I think that everybody got their own thing. That's why like I never really judge a lot of shit, because I think that everybody is different.
Dude, I'm trying not to judge anybody about that.
Yeah,
because I get it. Everybody has, like you're right, everybody has that. But at the same time, it's like what? Because I just don't understand it.
I mean, I don't either. They're just like, right, okay, right. For instance,
mm-hmm.
Marcus in Boomerang, yeah. right?
With the feet.
Yeah. Yes, I can't be when a girl got ugly feet. Like,
yeah, no, I understand, because like, it's an aesthetic thing. I'm not talking about that. Yeah. I'm saying, and this is, and maybe I should dive a little bit into what I'm trying to say. So what I'm trying to say is just the fact that, like, because they were saying that when they were wrestling with the women, they were gaining pleasure from it.
Yeah, yeah, they wanted to be dominated.
They weren't. Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. Like, they weren't wrestling. They was technically just getting beat up. And I'm like, I didn't understand how that was giving them some sort of satisfaction. Because I'm like, you getting your ass whooped.
Like, I mean, true.
Like,
true.
These niggas is basically masochists. But I'm just sitting there like, yo, like, you paying her to just toss you around. Like, how is that a thrill?
Yeah, I don't get that. And then, you know, like, like I say, like, this is this your thing? Look, it's your life, do what you want.
Sure, yeah.
But like, just that's also like guys who like watching their wife getting, you know what I'm saying, smashed. It's like,
that's wild.
I'm, you know what I mean?
That I'm like, judging.
Like people got their own shit. So it's just like, yo, do what you do. But like, yeah, and that shit was paying her bills. Like that was paying.
But and
she
it was
flying. Yo, she was flying from Los Angeles, bro, Texas, bro, Chicago, she said Miami.
Come on, man.
She's flying over the country. You know what I'm saying? To go to wrestle niggas, dudes. To
throw niggas around in the hotel room.
Yeah, like it's wild, man. And that's why I say
he had video. It's making videos. Like, fam. First and foremost, I don't wanna get leg locked into submission, bro, by no woman who can deadlift 10,000 pounds. That don't sound fun at all. Nothing about that was sounding at any point pleasurable. That's why I was confused. That I'm like, what pleasure are you gaining from this woman whooping on your ass?
Man, look, I say, there'll be things that we go through life that we'll never understand.
Never. You that's know what that's I mean? The one right there. That's but it's that in trying to understand Latin.
but where I was going, man, it's like that, and also I think that two things can be true. I think that they were fighting each other probably, mm-hmm. and I think that she may have been. No, I'm not gonna say may. I think she was an abused woman, but at the same time, when she killed Ray that day on Valentine's Day, mm-hmm. she did that shit because Ray was with another woman, and he came home and told her, "Yo, I'm leaving you for such sure. and such."
And then on Valentine's Day at all, come on, man.
Like, look, I don't even know if I should call him a G for that. I just don't think that's smart. Like, on Valentine's Day, you're going to be late coming home. Wow. And then you spend Valentine's Day with another woman, and then you go home. Yo, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to leave you for this woman. When you know she got a temper, it's like.
And she buff. Yeah,
buff as fuck. She ain't need that buffness because she just went to get. And this is what killed.
See, look at this. We got to show this picture again because you said she's 5'3". I don't care how I understand that. Look at her biceps, bro.
Yeah, Sally.
You telling me she couldn't have just caught him with a quick right? Come on.
Yeah,
man.
But you ain't showing Ray though.
No, I know what Ray looked like. Ray is a mountain. I'm just talking about this and just her though. Yeah, like, if she punched somebody, like, yeah, that's gonna hurt.
Yeah, you gonna feel it. But
she
I mean,
got the python. She, you know what I'm saying? Hulk Hogan better watch out.
True. True, mm-hmm. but like, yeah, I think that, and then to shoot him twice, and then do, the prosecutor. You will see this when you get to the third episode.
She was an ex-Marine too.
Both of them were ex-Marines.
Ray. I didn't hear the part about Ray being one, but I had definitely heard her when she was talking about that.
Man, she shot him with the shotgun,
mm-hmm.
so he fell on the floor. Cause like I say this, and we'll move on. Like she shot him in the abdomen or whatever. And then the prosecutor was like, it'd be different if, like, she shot him, right? Mm-hmm. And then the shell casing was in there.
Mm-hmm.
No, she went back to the bedroom, got another shell, dropped that shell out in the bedroom and went back and then shot him in the face. They were like, yo, that's premeditated. Like,
yeah.
Like what are you doing? And first of all, you shoot him twice. But the first reload, you reloaded in the bedroom? Come on, that wasn't no threat there. So, yeah. So,
but
yeah.
Once she had the shotgun, the threat was over with.
Yeah,
because you know how big he is. Because
she tried to say that he was lunging towards her, and then it was like.
Then she lied and said he wouldn't let me leave or some shit like that. I'm like, come on, bro, like full of shit. But that is good. I'm almost done with the second episode. I can't wait to finish this joint, but. Yeah, that's interesting. So, man, for me, I went down a little historical lane. I found this nice little docuseries also on Netflix. So this is a Netflix heavy what we watching. But it is called Ancient Apocalypse. And basically, this guy, he goes to various different places in the world. And he talks about how the ancient societies had basically either got wiped off the face of the earth, or he talks about how certain things happened in that in certain time periods, which were which were very important, you know what I'm saying, in as far as history goes, and it somehow affected society, which kind of brought a certain society or civilization, you know what I'm saying, to an end. And I'm only like 3 episodes in on that one, but man, it's some crazy stuff that they talking about on there. The first one start off where they talking about like a flood and like I think they in like Indonesia or somewhere in Asia, I know for a fact, but it's like how they talk about a flood that came through and kind of wiped everything away that you in this town that used to be, or in this city or whatever that used to be there. And basically they go through, they excavate the area and they talk about all the stuff that they find. And then they end up like some people have found like skeletons or skeletal remains. Like I know this is not the first time it's been on TV, because there's been other shows like this. This is the first time I've seen it on Netflix though, which is different from the others. But it's a part of a huger series. And like one of the series that I've seen, it was on National Geographic, and they found like a mass grave from like where like when like cavemen and shit was alive. And they found like a mass grave of like animal remains. So like however they would kill the animals and all that shit, like whatever they had left over, they would throw into the grave. So it was like a big mass animal grave, and that's how they would discard the rest of the animal that they didn't use or whatever. It was crazy, bro. So it's like being able to see all of this stuff that, you know what I'm saying, happened years and years ago, and then being able to see how far we've come as a, you know what I'm saying, as a people is pretty cool, man. You get to see a lot of interesting stuff and a lot of the stories that, you know, you hear and all that. The one I'm super, super interested in watching, though, is Pompeii. Because they did some excavation in Rome and was trying to figure out, you know what I'm saying, like exactly what happened in Pompeii. So for those who don't know, real quick, just quick history lesson. The story of Pompeii is there was a volcano. I believe the name was Mount Vesuvius or Vesuvius or one of them. I believe the first one is right, though. I think it's Vesuvius. And basically it erupted and it kind of swept out the whole civilization of Pompeii and basically buried everything, the whole city, under ash and volcanic lava, rubble, all that kind of stuff. And when they went to go excavate it, most of the city was still kind of there. So, you know what I'm saying, they still going through it to this day, and they finding different things of the city of Pompeii. So it's very, very interesting just to see, you know what I'm saying, like all the stuff that they talk about. So y'all go check that out. It's called Ancient Apocalypse. Super interesting, man. Super interesting.
Sounds like it, man. Damn. I might have to check that out myself.
Mm-hmm. It's just dope to see, you know what I'm saying, like, especially when, you know what I'm saying, we talk about history and then, you know, like you see little stuff in the books like gold coins or silver coins and stuff. It's interesting to see them actually going to look for it and finding that type of stuff, because ain't no telling what, you know what I'm saying, was really down there. And, you know what I'm saying, like just the stuff that we walking over. And then, you know, I get in my conspiracy bag and I be like, man, it's probably like hidden cities in that motherfucking everything. So super, super cool, bro.
Yeah, definitely. It sounds like it.
All right, man. So on to the main feature presentation. About to go ahead and hit you with this trailer, man, and then we're gonna get into it. If I can find it, there we go.
Shouldn't be doing this, but we were winning.
I could win a few million on each game. Supreme Press.
There was a wad of money, and it clicked. He's betting on his own games.
And then all of a sudden, the FBI was here.
Wire fraud, illegal gambling.
Let's go, baby.
You can never live a peaceful life when your life has become nothing but a lie.
Ooh, all right, man, listen. So we talking about Operation Flagrant Foul, a part of the Untold series on Netflix. Interesting is a, for lack of a better word, because this was wild, bro. Just real quick, they didn't know nothing about this until John Gotti got took down. That's crazy. That's wild, bro. Mean to tell me they only got caught because John Gotti was in trial at the time? And if it wasn't for that, if he could have stayed the Teflon Don for real, we still would have been having cheating refs. That's wild, bro.
Man, I found out so much just random facts throughout this thing, man. And then, yeah, like a lot Tom of the...
is a straight weirdo.
Yeah, but I also, like, you're going to hear me periodically throughout this thing saying I think that two things could be true.
Mm-hmm.
But before we get into that, man, I got a shout out to these people, man. Like the people that are involved in Untold,
mm-hmm.
like this series is, man. I've seen the rise and fall of and one.
That I still gotta watch that one. Yeah,
the Malice in the Palace one. I seen that one.
That was good.
We did the Manti Te'o one.
That was great.
And it's just like
that was the greatest ending to a documentary ever.
Hey, don't start, man. We're not doing it today.
I'm not. I just got shot them out because that was hilarious, bro. The fact they ended that doc like that was amazing.
That's funny, you stupid. But but yeah, like these series, man, they have been on point. They have done a really, mm-hmm. really good job with these Untolds, but like just a random fact that I never knew was that, like, all of the refs, because see, the thing about the NBA, if you watch the NBA enough, there are, even the NFL, there are certain refs that you mm-hmm. just know their names.
Yep.
All of the refs that I knew their names, like, how does Pennsylvania become
the ref capital of the world?
The ref capital. I'm like, hold up, man. And that's how it started. Mm-hmm. Like, that's how it started. Like, in the first 5 minutes, you hear Steve Jabry, Joe Crawford, Scott yep. Foster, Tim Donaghy's dad. It's yep. like, the fuck? Like, all of these dudes are from Pennsylvania? Like, are that's you kidding crazy. Me? That's like how California's like the quarterback capital. It's like mm-hmm. what the fuck? Like, how does Pennsylvania become like this whole thing of like, okay, this is, and then the crazy part was most of them came from the same county that Tim Donaghy came from.
Yeah, and they went to the same high school.
It was like, how does this happen? Like, so that was just a random fact that just completely threw me off. I was like, whoa, like, this is how we start this thing? We start this on how this small town in Pennsylvania is where like all the refs are coming from? Yeah. So I thought that was a very brilliant way to start this thing, but like it had me intrigued from right there. It was like, yeah. okay, this is like there's some kind of conspiracy thing going on here. I just don't understand how that became like the ref capital, but you know, but they tried to say the whole thing of like, well, I like how he said he kind of like, well, I mean, for number one, his dad was a ref, but like mm-hmm. how he was saying that the Philadelphia team at that time, you know, had the Dr. J, Mo Cheeks, and Moses Malone. He was just saying it like how he was in love with the Sixers, and he used to go to a lot of Sixer games. So, like, you can see how, you know, someone could, especially when you love your sport, but you know you're not good enough to play. I think that's what a lot of people who become refs.
Or just people like that, coaches or trainers or any of that. Like, just the fact that you can somehow be involved in it one way or the other, to me, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's the greatest part about it is you don't always have to be the athlete. You know what I'm saying? You can be mm-hmm. You can be a trainer. You know, you can be a coach. You can be an assistant. You can be, you know what I'm saying, a ref. Or, you know what I'm saying, for some people, owners or, you know what I'm saying, like general managers or whatever. Like, there's other avenues you can take to still be a part of the game without actually being in the game. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the dope part about sports to me.
Yeah, I agree with you 100% there. But yeah, I just thought that was interesting. Like, I never knew that was coming. But Tim Donaghy, man, like, it's a very weird case.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I want to start right out the gate with something that he had said, and this was towards the end when he was like, there are only, if I'm not mistaken, I think he said 50 NBA refs.
Mm-hmm. No, 60.
60. 60. So 60. He was like, I was in efficiency, I was ranked third. And it's like, to be betting on games.
Yeah.
And the guy said that he was 37-10 in the pitch that Tim mm-hmm. gave him. Mm-hmm. But to be third in efficiency?
I mean, but you gotta remember, like, even when they talked about his very first game in the NBA, you know what I'm saying? Reggie Miller is pump faking and jumping into him. And soon as, you know what I'm saying, Reggie Miller make the move, and they in Indiana, he calls it offensive foul on Reggie Miller, change the game around, and Houston win.
Yeah.
And, you know, they like, yo, like, you know, and it's crazy how you don't realize just how much of a relationship that these guys have. And it's funny because we just talked about this on the 4-3 about the refs coming to talk to Mike Evans. Mm-hmm. But, you know, saying like, you don't realize that the way that they treat suit, like, these guys are really superstars, not just in the regular life, but like even in the league, they're superstars. And they talked a lot about this as well, just about how they like how certain players get certain calls or how they won't get certain calls on them. And, you know what I'm saying, like, the head ref was like, yo, you better hope that he made this move, because if not, like, it's going to be – you're going to have some hell to pay. And luckily, you know what I'm saying, he made the right call. And you can even hear – they even had the announcers talking about it, how, you know what I'm saying, they were like, yo, you know what I'm saying, if he's going to be one of the, you know what I'm saying, refs or long-standing refs in this league, you know, he has to make the right calls. And, you know what I'm saying, this is one of the right calls that he's made. So, like, even doing that, and, you know what I'm saying, like, against Reggie Miller in Indiana, and, like, that's the guy on the team, you know what I'm saying? Like, he's a superstar in the NBA. To make that call on him was already a bold move. And that's his first game ever reffing. So, you know what I'm saying? Like, you could tell that when he started off, he wanted to do the right thing. He wanted to be a great ref. He wanted to be one of the ones that, you know what I'm saying, like you said, eventually gets up to, you know what I'm saying, that top position, which – as you could tell, he already did. But to me, I think that what ended up happening was he got so good at it that he just realized, like, yo, this is something that I could possibly do. And then he realized that he can kind of take control of the games in a way, because he told dude, yo, I can decide a game either way by 6 points.
Mm-hmm.
You know how good you have to be able to do that and not get caught to where it's like it don't even look like you cheating. Yes, yeah. Bro. So for him being number three in efficiency, I'm not surprised. If he can call a game either way by 6 points in a basketball game, yo, that's great.
That's severely great, and that's,
yeah.
It's a very tough thing to be able to explain. But at the same time, like I was saying, I think that two things can be true. And something that we have noticed about the NBA is, yes, when it comes to the Michael Jordans, the Reggie Millers, and all of those guys, yes, they don't call certain calls on these guys.
Yo, when they got to talk about Michael Jordan, bro, I was
spin,
like,
move.
Man,
he called it. He called it on him, and he was just like, he basically got a call from the league. Like,
he got it way before that. He got it after the call. Phil Jackson said, "Hey man, what you doing?" He said, "That's come on, Phil. You know this the move that you know this they cracking down on us. They want us to call this move." He said, "Yeah, they don't want you to call it on him."
Him though, yeah.
They was like, "Yo, in a game,
yo, that's crazy. It's crazy, man. It's crazy how it is." But you can also, like what Tim ended up explaining, you also get it. Like, if you sit in courtside, you're paying thousands, tens of thousands of dollars to sit on the floor, and you want – he was like, you don't want to see, you know what I'm saying, the highest player on the team be sitting on the bench, you know what I'm saying, because he's in foul trouble or whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. So it's like that's just one of those things that has been accepted in the game. It's like I don't think it was a secret. It's different hearing it from NBA.
It's more like an unwritten rule, but at the same time, like the fact that they're so blatant with it,
yeah,
like that's what makes it kind of like, you know what I'm saying? Like, cause you like even in the NFL, right? Like, you know, it's certain dudes that hit a certain way, or you know what I'm saying? Like, it's certain, like for instance, the Tom Brady thing. Like, we all know you can't hit Tom Brady. Yeah. But when it gets to the point to where, like, if Tom Brady get up, like, come on, Tom, you know, they want me to call that. Yeah, but you don't call it on me. And then he walk off. You'll be like, the fuck? Nah, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just the fact that just the audacity to be able to even say it. Like, if it's an unwritten rule, cool, let it be unwritten. But yeah, to just blatantly just outright say it, come on, man. To me, that's what really takes away the integrity of the game, because, you know, if a dude is coming down court and he sees Michael Jordan do that and he can do the same shit Michael Jordan do for real, but when he do it, he getting a call and Michael Jordan ain't, you really stifling the league.
I'll say, like, if we're talking about the league today, mm-hmm. like, let's say somebody like,
oh, nowadays it don't even matter because they be carrying their ass off in the game.
I mean that too, but I'm trying to think of a guy that was. Let me see. If it's somebody like, shit, I don't even want to say Ben Simmons. I'm trying to think of a guy like, okay, Marcus Smart.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say Marcus Smart was the person who came up with the James Harden step back. They call him walk. They call him travel every time.
Yeah, it's over with.
But because it's James Harden, they're not gonna call it like that,
bro.
Now they did fuck James Harden. They get
Draymond for every foul.
Yeah,
lets you know like that's what because they didn't do that to Dennis Rodman until he got with the Bulls.
But I will say this though, and Draymond was talking about this on I forget who he was talking about it with, but So, no. It was what's my guy name? Rasheed Wallace.
Okay.
So Rasheed Wallace, like there during the game, and Rasheed, I'm talking about cussing the ref out. He was on all the smoke. He's cussing the refs out, you know, this and that. And so then the guy that was playing him was like, he just said, you know, they caught a foul on him. Man, that's bullshit.
Tech.
Yeah, and he was like, he said, man, Rasheed been cussing you out all game. He was like, yeah, but that's Rasheed. Like, we know him. Like, that's just how he is. That's how he talks. But, like, so Rasheed got leeway because everybody knows this is how he talks during the game.
Mm-hmm.
This is just, like, anytime you about to officiate this guy, we got to let him get a couple of bullshit fuck yous out of here because that's just him. Like, that's the way he plays. But if you're not a player that has that reputation, you can't do it. Like, they're going to call a tech on you. So it's just one of those things where it's like two things can be true. Like, it does messes up the integrity of the game. But then at the same time, it's like that's who a lot of people pay to see.
Mm-hmm.
Like, majority of those tickets, they're just like, when the Heat first got together, every away game, everybody got to raise their tickets.
Yeah.
Because they were like, yo, we got LeBron, Bosh, and Wade coming in here.
Mm-hmm.
So all we'll play, like, let's say it's Charlotte, and Charlotte play the Pelicans. It's like, all right, you know, you can get in the game $200, $250. But, you know what I'm saying, if it's Charlotte and you got the Heat coming in, That $250 ticket.
Oh, that's now was $650.
Yeah,
easily an $800 game.
That's, I mean, that's just what it is.
That's the same way now. Like, even if you think about it, like if you know, or I'm not saying now, but I'm saying like when you think of Cleveland, like remember Cleveland's economy boosted when LeBron was on the team.
Yeah,
both times. I mean, boosted, and then once they talk about a lot. Like once he left, like yo, it went right back down. So, I mean, like, just the fact that, you know what I'm saying, like, they bring that kind of – certain players bring that kind of value, you know what I'm saying, that's understandable. And, of course, you know, like you said, and like he said, you know, you when you pay your money, you want to see the stars of the game. However, the whole purpose of having a ref there is to implement the rules. So, yeah. If LeBron is doing, like, for instance, LeBron travels his ass off. They never call it. They never call it. But because he's LeBron, you know, he can take an extra step every now and then. Or, I mean, I've seen Devin Booker do it. I've seen Steph do it. I've seen Klay get off with it a couple of times. Like, with the stars, they give them a lot of leeway. However, if you know what I'm saying, you coming in at backup and you ain't got the juice, yo, you getting called. And that, to me, I think it felt like more so an indictment on the league more so than it did anything else. And not like a in-your-face indictment, but just the fact that there's all these unwritten rules and all of these, you know what I'm saying, unsigned treaties and you know what I'm saying, under the table contracts amongst the players and the refs and the refs and the owners and the refs and the, you know what I'm saying, the commissioner at the time. And it's like, you sit here and you look and you like, yo, like, so really when people be like, yeah, these games are rigged, you kind of looking at this and you like, well, shit, yeah, they rigged a lot for real if you think about it, because they kind of telling you everything that's going on. You know what I'm saying? Behind the scenes, and you really have no idea. The fact that, you know what I'm saying, like, we didn't even know that a ref could make certain calls and really control a game, he really put that into perspective for me, because you hear it a lot of times, like, yeah, you know, a ref can change the game instantly. And I know in football, it definitely can happen. And it don't even have to be cheating. It could just be the ref actually see something and actually call it instead of just letting it slide. And then, you know, the whole momentum go away. But in basketball, I didn't think that it was like in basketball, it's times 1,000. Because if a team is down by 2 and you got 40 seconds on the clock and they come down and they got the ball in the star's hand and he make a move and you just blow the whistle and be like, travel. Like, bro, that's it. Dude, ain't no challenges, ain't no none of that. It's just nah, bro. It's a travel. Give them the ball. It's over with.
Like the perfect example was the Iverson thing.
Yeah.
He completely threw Iverson out of his game. You know what I'm saying?
That's crazy to think that somebody who really ain't even, I mean, he has a lot to do with the game, but he really, like, he ain't playing defense. He ain't coming down shooting the ball against you. It's just a dude on the sideline, like, yo, I got to make this 500 tonight. Soon as he get the ball, we're going to call it travel.
Carry.
Yeah.
Palm, they were calling it Palm. Like, they kept calling Palm on him, and it's like, yeah, because, like, what that does is you kind of, like, now when you're about to do that crossover, if they call you twice, that third time you're probably thinking about it. So now that crossover might not be as effective. And because you're thinking about it.
You're trying to change it midway and in the middle.
Exactly.
You in a game, you trying to think in your head while you playing defense or while you on the, like, bro, how can I change this real quick so they ain't going to call it on me? Now you ain't dribbling the same because you trying to make sure you're dribbling a certain way. So that is wild. Just the effect that a call can just have on somebody's psyche like that is crazy.
Yeah. And, but I like how I just think it's funny how the NBA commented on a few things. Like, they didn't want to be interviewed,
right?
But they commented on a few things, like throughout the film or whatever. And it's just like I think the NBA was, I think they knew once, like, some of the shit came out that they integrity. Like, that's why they buried the whole Tim Donaghy trial. is because they were just like we don't want like the fans to think this is what's really going on. So like the NBA kind of like commented on some things and like their TV deal where they got $7.4 billion. You know what I'm saying? Like that was going on around the same time Tim fucking court trial was going on, and like how they just was able to bury it, and then how my one dude was he the sheep? Yeah, Jimmy. How Jimmy was saying that he was facing 3 charges. And then he was like, he knows for a fact that David Stern stepped in and dropped those 2 charges and gave him a lesser charge. And it's just like,
because Donahue only went down for wire fraud.
And yeah, he went for 15 months and he thought that he wasn't going to get any time.
Yeah, he didn't even get hit with betting in sports. He got hit with wire fraud. That's it.
Yeah, these motherfuckers didn't even get for them, basically not washing money, but tax evasion, none of that shit.
None of that.
They didn't get none of it. Like my man said, I was making. He said that, you know, 1 week I might lose $3 million. Next week I won 6, and it's just like, man,
let's talk about that though. Let's talk about that. This nigga Tim Donahue said he only made $30,000, bro.
Get the fuck out of here. Yo, did you hear how he answered the question the first time? And then the second time, he's all definitive all of a sudden.
Come on, fam.
The fuck out of here, Tim.
That man asked him, yo, that you said you only make that. Did you possibly make more than what you say you did? I don't know. You don't know? You talking about all these cars you got, this fancy house, and all these other things that you got and acquired? And then all of a sudden, you don't want them anymore because you don't want it to seem like you're making all of this money. You don't want to be flashy because you're making all of this money. Like, come on, bro. Stop, man. $30,000? You basically got a regular person's salary for a year, and you telling me you, out of 47 bets, the 37 you won, that all totaled up to $37,000. And these niggas was betting millions. What my man say? A dime was five. A nickel was five.
A nickel was
500. Was a stack. A stick was 100,000, and a balloon was 1,000,000. You telling me all these balloons, and they ain't pop you nothing but 30,000? Nah, brother. Nah, I refuse.
Fuck
to
believe
out of that. Here. I refuse to believe that.
Tim lied his ass off.
The fact that his wife found the wad of money in a jacket,
and you didn't even know you left it in there.
Come on, bro. That's how I know he made more than $30,000.
Yeah.
With $30,000, you're going to find that wad of money because $30,000 ain't much.
Man, listen. Tim probably made at least about 10% of every damn bet, at least.
10%? Hell nah. You talking about the dude on the court making the calls? He had to get like at least 20-25, bro.
I mean, I feel you, but you also got to understand, like, once Jimmy started fucking with the mob people, you know they always take over.
They do.
And they always get the biggest cut.
They got the biggest cut for sure. But 10%? Nah, he got way more than 10, bro.
He probably did, but he got way more than 30,000. That was a bold lot.
He's making the cut. First and foremost, he's calling the bets to begin with. Not only is he calling the bets, he's also going and saying, hey, man, look, I got the inside track on the game. You know what I'm saying? Mo Cheeks doing bad. You know what I'm saying? They tanking. They playing up against a pretty good team. They got some shooters. Yo, they going to lose this one. You know what I'm saying? Bet them. Bet the line. Bet it all. They going to lose this one. Parlay it up. It ain't no way, bro. $30,000 is way too meager for what he was doing.
And
they probably wouldn't if he really I mean to cut you off, but if he really made $30,000, they probably wouldn't even have had indicted him.
Tim, he know he made more than that. I think the thing with Tim, I think that, and they brought it up in this thing. I think that like people that are like habitual liars and shit, it's just like they lie. Yeah, it's like they lie so much where like, you know, like they just really lose touch with reality for number one. But then at the same time, I think with Tim, it's like even when you're telling the truth, it's hard to get other people to believe you. And I think exactly. And I think that he was. I tell you one thing. I think he lied about. I don't think Jimmy threatened his family.
No, Jimmy ain't threatening his family. Jimmy didn't threaten his family. Come on, bro. They was all cool.
Well, Jimmy tried to say that he just knew of Tim. Like,
what was the other dude? It was Jimmy.
Tommy,
the weirdo. Tommy was cool with both of them.
Yeah.
So they kind of came together, even though they all went to the same high school, they kind of came together because of Tommy. But even still, though, like, dude, he ain't no way he threatened you and told you some wild stuff like that and was like, yo, you know what I mean? You really ain't got no choice. No, bro. He seen the opportunity. He knew that he can make this possible. He knew he can get paid from it, and it wouldn't have been an issue.
And he knew he could do it with even being one of the – I mean, obviously, speaking by the numbers, he was one of the best refs in the league.
But that's what I'm saying. By being the best ref in the league, you already know you can do it. First and foremost, being the best ref in the league, right, that means that you own all the major games, so you always around the stars. You know who the players are. The players know you. You know who the coaches are. I mean, like, you got certain relationships and all that type of stuff that most people don't have. So, I mean, yeah, it's easy to say that, oh, he threatened me. Nah, he ain't threatening him, man. I don't believe it at all. I think he seen the opportunity and he bit on the opportunity.
Yeah, I think that he definitely lied about that. He lied about the $30,000. But I think that some of the inside scoop that he gave, like, about the NBA, and then also the whole shit with calling Scott Foster before and after, even during halftime, this motherfucker was calling him. Mm-hmm. So I think that. And Scott Foster still repping to this date.
Yeah.
But I think Scott Foster was involved. Because it's like,
look, they said that out of 60 refs, 45 was questioned. And only a handful of them got hit with something. So that lets you know, like, they had something going for real. This was way bigger than whatever the Tim Donaghy situation was.
Yeah.
Had to be, because out of 60 of them, 45, bro, so that means it's only 15 that wasn't in it, and that's probably because, like, they was like the lower level guys, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's crazy.
Yeah, that's just like that damn 30 for 30, man. Oh man, it was playing for the Mob or some shit like that, where it was like a whole like thing. It wasn't the Big East. Oh man, they were like betting on these games. I forget what it was, and it was just like, yo, like, this shit is like a whole fucking like enterprise, mm-hmm. And it's just like the amount of money that's involved in the NBA, and like David Stern said, like, this was the biggest thing that David Stern had to deal with. Like, this was his biggest controversy, and David Stern, being as smart as he was, and also being a bully like he was.
That nigga was ruthless.
Oh, he was definitely ruthless. Like, but at the same time, he took the NBA to the next level. Like,
for sure.
As far as like commissioners, like, he's got to be number one.
He's definitely top two.
I think Paul Tagliabue.
Yeah, I'm about to say Tagliabue is definitely the one.
Yeah, but like,
but
I'm gonna tell you why I'm gonna go David Stern first. Remember when David Stern took over? NBA Finals was on tape delay.
No, you're right. That's what I was just about to say, because I was about to say, well, he did have a hand in the whole Jordan thing too.
Yes.
They found a way to make Jordan like the premium star. So you might be right. Sterling might be number one, because you got to think about it. Like, when Sterling came in and did his thing, and he was, you know what I'm saying? Like, you had like Dr. J, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, but then, like, he made the whole rivalry thing happen, like Bird and Magic, the Pistons in Jordan, and you know what I'm saying? Like, you had the certain teams that just people had to come see, people had to watch or whatever. And, like, then not only that, like, getting it on TV, and like you said, even though it was on tape delay, like, yo, bringing in live games now, like, he really changed a lot of stuff around.
Yeah, and for him to take the NBA to the next level like he did, the money, just look at the way the money changed in the NBA when he took over. But to be able to, because the thing is, when you're dealing with billionaires, like he's dealing with billionaires on a daily basis, messing with TV people, TV contracts, like the NBA has its hands in so many different baskets.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it's very easy for him to pick up the phone. Yo, drop this, and this. We need to get this out of here.
The only thing I'll never forgive him for, though, is making them wear suits.
Yeah, like the whole thing of like
all them big ass suits that everybody had on. That shit was horrible, bro.
Well, I mean, that was. You're not talking about the draft. You're just talking about like when they showed up to the game.
Yeah, no, I'm talking about the draft too. Niggas was wearing big ass Steve Harvey suits to the games in the draft. Like, yeah, bro. Like making them dress business attire was a bad choice. None of these niggas had tailors.
I mean, true, but the way the suits used to fit back then was different.
They didn't. Suits have always been the same throughout time. They needed tailors. None of these niggas had a tailor. these niggas went to Macy's and bought a suit and wore it. You get your suit tailored.
Man, you stupid.
They had the money to do it.
So so we're talking about Tim Donaghy, all these refs, right?
Yeah.
So I brought up the 30 for 30, right? Where I said playing for the mob. Dude, this was mafia associate that was friends with Henry Hill, from mm-hmm. Goodfellas.
Mm-hmm.
But we're talking about one season in one school, Boston College.
Oh, that's not surprising.
This is the whole NBA.
Yeah.
Like, that situation was just one school. You know what I'm saying? That's taking games. Yeah, they're the one that got caught.
Yeah.
But it's just like, but we're talking about, I mean, this is major. And for Tim was really the fall guy. But the way that the NBA cleaned this thing up, I mean, because mm-hmm. I remember about hearing about the Tim Donaghy shit, because that's when I used to be heavy in the ESPN radio. So yeah. It was like you're constantly hearing about it, but then like the shit just stopped. Like it just went away. Like it just completely disappeared. And it
was, what year was this? This was around like the.
This was.
This had to be like early 2000s.
No, I think it was late 2000s. Cause I remember seeing something about 2009, if I'm not mistaken. Because he got, when did he get charged? Now I can't find it. But Iverson was Denver, because see, they went to the championship in 2001, and mm-hmm. he probably went to Denver around 2003, 2004, 2005-ish. So it was so this was going on because he got charged in 2009.
No, I want to say he was with Denver in like 07, 08.
No. He was with Denver. Probably like, no, I mean, I think he was with Denver around that time. Because I think he played with Denver like 2 or 3 years.
No, you know what? You might be right. Because I'm trying to think. 02. So from, because 01 is the finals when they played the Lakers.
Yeah, and that was 2001.
I want to say he was on the Sixers for maybe 2 or 3 years after that.
Something like that, because he wasn't even Memphis for a year, he wasn't even in Detroit for a year.
Yeah, because Melo came in in 03.
Yes, because we always talk about like that might be the greatest draft.
Yeah, and then that's when, because I want to say they had JR, they had Kenyon Martin, they had Melo in them. Yeah, that might have been, you might be right. That might be like 05, 06. Okay, yeah, you might be right, definitely. Okay.
Okay, so he started being investigated in the summer of 2007.
Oh, that's when Tim started being investigated. You're right. So it is late 2000s. Yo, that is crazy. So that means that, that means that, like, all them games he was officiating, and this is the wild part about it all, right? Like, this is when betting was getting, like, to the point to where it was, like, major.
It was still undercover, but, like, nowadays,
now it's out there because, like, they partner with leagues and shit. I'm talking about the where, like, when I'm talking about the betting thing, I'm talking about, like, this is when shows was just popping up about, like, betting. Remember, it was a show on CNN about it where it was a dude that used to do the stocks and then he would do the sports bets and then he'd do something else. It's like he used to do all that shit. He used to be standing up talking and he used to have a microphone in front of him and he'd just be pushing buttons with the sounds and shit on it. But he used to talk about stocks going up and down and all that, the losses and the gains. And then he'd be talking about like the major sports bets and all that. And then, even around this time, they was even announcing, and it wasn't on like ESPN or nothing, but they were still announcing, like they would announce it like on the radio or something like that and tell you what the line was. And it was in the papers. You know what I'm saying? You what the line was in Vegas for the game.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm saying. Like, this is when it was starting to get like major to the point to where like it wasn't accepted, but it was to the point to where like, yo, if you wanted to go put a bet, you can find somewhere to go find out what the, you know what I'm saying, what the line was and go get you some money.
This is what I want to know. So you know how they making, you know how they just made, if you got a federal weed charge that they're letting you out of jail now.
Yeah.
So for guys that got arrested for being a bookie, did these motherfuckers get out now too?
Nah, probably not.
Because they got to be pissed. They're like, oh, okay, so what I was doing, yeah, because it was illegal, but now is...
You got to think about they charge. Like, they charges is different. They charges is like racketeering, embezzlement, and all that shit. So that's, they really ain't even see, and this is why I said it's weird because, like, even with him, they're not getting charged for gambling.
Yeah,
like them dudes that was like bookies and shit, they're not getting in trouble for gambling. Like, even the dudes with the mob, them niggas didn't get in trouble for gambling, them niggas got in for racketeering, embezzlement, tax evasion, fraud, and all these other things. Like, these they getting hit with like criminal charges. They ain't getting hit with, I mean, gambling is a criminal charge, but they're not getting hit with that specific charge, which to me, I think that if he got hit with the gambling or if they got hit with the gambling thing, it, like, especially now, that shit could probably be wiped away, you know what I'm saying? No harm, no foul. But the charges that they were getting thrown on them, I think that's why it was such a big deal, because the fact that even with him, he was gambling on games, but when they was bringing up the charges, they were talking about wire fraud.
Yeah, that's,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. This was crazy, man. It was definitely a really good watch, and it also brought back memories of, you know, watching some of the players, man, that we really grew up watching. You know, it was funny to see the Reggie Miller call.
When that nigga sent Bonzi Wells and oh my god, what is the other dude's name?
Who was on that Portland team?
He was another forward. Might have been the center.
You're not talking about Rasheed, was you?
No, not Rasheed.
Sabonis.
No, it wasn't Sabonis.
I thought I saw him though. Who else is on that team?
It was a white dude, man. I'm about to say Myers Leonard, but it ain't Myers Leonard.
Oh, hell no.
I forgot what dude's name is. But Austin, no. Man, I forgot, but I know he got two of them niggas out of there, and that changed the whole game.
And then the crazy thing is how they brought up the Kings and the Lakers. and how that was, they said that was the worst officiated game in like history or some shit like that. And he was like, and these motherfuckers still got the ref another game. Like, that was crazy. I think that they definitely should have been penalized for that, because they do that shit in football. Like, it's like the guys who got like the worst grades, like these motherfuckers don't get to go to the playoffs. Nope. And shit. So it's they'll like
do a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I think the NBA really, I mean, look, the NBA is very powerful. They dropped the ball on a few things, but they really dropped the ball on that, because that's going to stand out to the end of time. Because a lot of people, if you ask people the question, real basketball heads, who's the best team to never win a championship? A lot of people's going to say that Sacramento Kings team.
Yeah. They had Peja Stojakovic. They had Vlade Divac. They had Chris Webber, Mike Bibby. They had
Steve Christie.
Yeah, Doug Christie. They had Doug Christie. Man, they had a they really had a squad.
They had a squad. And like,
and then this was the dope thing too, though, the fact that they were one of the first teams to start using those international players. You know what I'm saying? Like, between them, the Spurs, trying to think who else was using those European players at the time. The Mavs had Dirk, but like the fact that you know what I'm saying, like they had Peja on the team, they had Divac on the team. Like, Peja was probably one of the best 3-point shooters of all time.
Oh yeah, Peja's in my top. He's in my top 10. But dude, this is what's crazy. Easily. This is how old we get. I just saw a couple of days ago, Peja Stojakovic's son just committed to Stanford. Yeah, it's like we're seeing all of these now. I could understand what our parents was talking about. You know what I'm saying? Because we watched the fathers or even the mothers play, and it's like now we're seeing like the kids play too, and it's just like
Because what's her name? Levy played for the Detroit Shock. Her son played for the Pistons.
Yeah, like it is getting crazy. I never got to see and I probably did, but just didn't know it was her. But JaVale McGee mom played in the women's NBA.
Yep.
You know, and it's just like it's crazy. I mean, I watched Pat Sertan. Now Pat Sertan Jr. is the fucking step down corner. It's like
dog too.
Ed McCaffrey. Now I got Christian McCaffrey to watch on Sundays. Yeah. It's like, God, boy, it's just like, man, I'm getting up there, man. I saw that shit. I was like, man, this is crazy.
Yo, but to see Randy Moss' son win a national championship was crazy to me.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
And then Jason Taylor's son caught the winning touchdown. At LSU. So it's just like it's wild, man.
Yeah, for sure, man. So man, let's go ahead and get into these fire flames, Brody.
Let's do it.
Yoga fire. Yoga flame.
Okay, so this one, I want to take the reins, man. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going to go 4.5. Only because the information, it was a lot of information in this documentary. Mm-hmm. And not only that, we kind of got a chance to see the behind-the-scenes glimpse of how the NBA worked at that time. And to grow up in that era specifically, to be able to see kind of like the tail end of the Jordan era, the beginning of the Kobe era, the very beginning of the LeBron era, you know what I'm saying? Like, you got to see, you know what I'm saying, the back-to-back Lakers, you know what I'm saying, the back-to-back-to-back Bulls, like, getting to see all those teams and knowing that this dude had a hand in basically changing, you know what I'm saying, the history of this whole league by just a few calls a game and betting on it. And now, you know what I'm saying, like they had to revamp the way refs ref the game or, you know what I'm saying, dealt with players. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just a whole bunch of different things. Because, like, I think before this, it was kind of cool for the refs to be cool with the – and even kind of still, you see it on TV a lot, how, like, some of the players, like, yo, they chatted up with the refs. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. it's nothing. So to be able to see that, like, you know, it kind of opens your eyes to the fact that, you know, even though it's kind of unethical for them to, you know what I'm saying, like, be kind of buddy-buddy on the court, you still get, you know what I'm saying, you still see a lot of these players talking to the refs a certain way, and, you know, either they're yelling and screaming at them, or, you know what I'm saying, they trying to buddy up to them and grease them up before the game so they can get a few calls. But to see how, you know what I'm saying, like, they had this whole operation working, and they were so good at what they did that even the commissioner, even the coaches, even the players didn't even realize that this was something that they was doing. That's just, you know what I'm saying, with, you know what I'm saying, goes to show you, like, yo, these guys really were on point with what they were doing, even though they were doing something super illegal. And then not only that, the characters of this documentary. Anytime you deal with guys that were like mafia or dealing with the mafia, they always just, they just characters, bro. Like, just the fact that my man Tom said, I seen a bird shit on a pole, and I wanted to know what the bird shit tasted like. So I tasted the bird shit. I said, he should have never been able to do anything, sir. What made you want to do that? Like, what could possibly go through your head to be like, I wonder what that tastes like? And this the nigga that they got out there reffing?
He wasn't reffing, man. He didn't ref.
He shouldn't ref. Like, so he wasn't a ref.
No, man. Okay, cool. He was his friend. He was his.
He was friends with a referee, and that automatically lets me know the niggas ain't right. The fact they friends with him lets me know that nigga Tom was sick. But outside of that, man, this was a great documentary, man. Like I said, as far as even just the nostalgic reasonings behind it made it that much great. And then not only that, man, this is one of the biggest sports stories of our time. The fact that we had a guy who was basically, I guess you could go ahead and say it, throwing games, you know what I'm saying, for his own personal gain and profit, and ended up getting caught. And to me, the wildest part of it all was he was going to get away scot-free if it wasn't for John Gotti. Like, that blows my mind, bro. The fact that the only reason that these dudes even got on the radar, when nobody looking for him, when nobody checking for him, didn't nobody know. They just happened to hear his name on the recording because of the John Gotti case. That is wild to me. But yeah, I'm going 4.5.
I mean, it had a lot of information, like you said, a ton of information. I'm surprised that the TV stations and the NBA like allow as much footage that they allowed. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But I think what the NBA was trying to do was like, all right, if we block a lot of the stuff, it's going to look suspicious. So we kind of need to let them get what they get off. We're not going to necessarily like voice our answers or have a video of our answers. We just, you know, we're going to tell them to put a disclaimer that we said this. You know what I'm saying? To counter something. So I thought that was cool, because usually you see stuff like we asked to interview such and such, and they said we don't want to be interviewed.
Right.
So for them to answer the questions that they answered, I think they would try to throw off suspicion. Like you said, I think Jimmy was a character. Yeah. You know what I mean? Just how animated he got about stuff. I thought that he was a very interesting character. And Tim, being the guy that he is, and even his wife was like, yo, there's going to be shit that Tim take to the grave. Like, he's not never going to admit to certain things. And with all that being said, man, I'm going to go 4, just a notch below you.
Okay.
But like I said in the beginning, man, these untold, you know, I haven't seen all of them, but I've seen at least like 4, maybe 5. These things has been really good, man. They got a really good thing going. So like
big time.
Yeah. So Netflix, I hate to say it, but man, I don't think they're going to win. I know everybody try to say, "Oh man, Netflix falling off." And, nah.
Bro. Yeah. Good luck with that.
Yeah.
Good luck with that. Yeah, that this is just a wild story in general, man. But let's get into the coming soon, man.
Let's do it.
Coming soon to own on video and DVD.
All right, man. So what we have next is a very interesting movie for the world to hear and see. This actually was a pretty good movie. I was surprised when I seen it. I had heard about it, and the premise alone had got me. I wanted to see how they were going to bring this all around, and they did a wonderful job of it. But we're talking about the recently released horror movie X, and it's just a good movie, to say the least.
Yeah, they brought that 70s vibes back
for sure.
I thought that was really the dopest thing about this movie. Mm-hmm. With the fact that they did that, and then like the story within the story that they're shooting a porn movie, like that's wild. Like within it, you know, within itself, and to go on location,
mm-hmm.
like so that's another thing. But like, yeah, it's gonna be an interesting movie to break down, man, because it definitely wasn't what I thought it was gonna be
at all. At all, bro.
Like
this, yeah. It's nothing like I thought it was gonna be.
Yeah. So and then it got some creepy shit in it, which yeah. So that's gonna be fun to break down.
The definitely horror part is not them getting killed. The horror. Well, never mind. I tell you what the real horror part was in the movie.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
we're on the same page.
Yeah, because I was like. Why? Like, why was that necessary?
We did not need this scene
at all, like, bro.
Man, with the girl under the bed, we didn't need it.
Even before that, like when she, I was just like that. Whoever the makeup team was on that movie, A1, top notch, bro. Like, they did an amazing job. Because I was like, I was creeped out when that happened. I was like, you know what? I'm good. they don't need no more nudity in scary movies at this point. They taking it too far for me. But, yeah. So, you guys stay tuned for that episode, man. We'll see you on the next one. Can't wait for it. But until then, if you liked this episode, if you didn't like this episode, if you want to tell us how great this documentary was, or, you know what I'm saying, if you want to find out what the real amount Tim Donahue made and tell us, let us know, hit us up on the socials. Hit us up on the socials on Instagram and Twitter at View and I Pod. You can also find us on Facebook at VA Pod Watch Group. And then if you'd like to find me personally, you can hit me up on Twitter at Scoots Bronson. I have a link tree in the bio. You can find me everywhere else there. Also, if you are into video games, hit me up on Twitch. That's at Scoots Bronson on Twitch. And I just dropped my album. I'm sorry about to say my next album. I just dropped another album. Y'all go check that out. It's on all streaming platforms. It's called Elation. It's, of course, Scoots Bronson. So search me up, listen to it, dance music. And this time I took my time and put a little bit more effort into this one. And I like the way this one came out. And that's all I got.
What's up, man? Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
For me, y'all can find me at s.foster8 on Instagram and on Twitter. At 28 minutes or less pod, just on IG. And also, for some odd reason, I don't really know what the hell's going on with Facebook. Like, I had a 28 minutes or less page and they took it. And like, I had by mistake created a Stolen Time pod page on Facebook and they took it. But for some odd reason, like in the last like 2 months, they just gave it back to me.
Yeah, they did that to me too, because they took away because I got an isolated society page on there for my gaming.
For yeah.
But yeah, they took it down and then they brought it back up, and I just had to like add all the stuff back on there. But yeah, it's weird.
I haven't done that yet. I just, man, me and Facebook just ain't vibing right now. So it was like, I don't know if I really want to You know what I mean? But I mean, if y'all want to follow, y'all can. I'm just saying, Slow Time Pod on Facebook. That's out there too. Follow the podcast, 28 minutes or less, man, on all major platforms. I got a great idea for my next pod, and I'm gonna. I don't know if it's necessarily conspiracy, but I just got like a lot of shit I want to get off. And
if you do a conspiracy, I want in on this shit, bro. I mean, I want in on it.
It's not necessarily conspiracy, but it can kind of be in that vibe. But
I thought you were going conspiracy theories. I'm about to say, yeah, I gotta at least get 10 minutes in. I want in. if you ain't doing it, then do your thing. But if you're doing conspiracy theories, hit me up.
I'm gonna have to at some point.
That'll be a fun pod.
Yeah, that's definitely something that we could do in the future. But now it's not a conspiracy pie. It's just more.
It's some conspiracy around it.
Kind of, sort of, yeah.
Oh yeah,
and just really kind of like my theory on certain shit. And I got like a lot of things that I want to use to try to. I don't necessarily prove my theory. Just one of those type things. So be on the lookout, man, for this. This will be episode 105. So be on the lookout for episode 105 soon. Also, the 4-3, we will be popping. I know once this come out, it's gonna be past 10:30. But you know, y'all can always go back and watch the video. And Scoots is gonna be working tonight because he's gonna post all of those pods on Spotify and all the major platforms that haven't been up.
Yeah, I am. I'm going to do my best with this retweeting laptop that I have.
But yeah, y'all go check out those pods, man. We got some great topics coming up this week. So be on the lookout for the 4-3 as well. Mm-hmm.
For sure, man. Just to let y'all know, I'm going to tell you how horrible this laptop is. The stuff that you see that pops up as far as the graphics, I'm not doing any of that from my laptop. I'm doing that all from my phone while I'm using my laptop to record myself. So that just lets you know how trash this laptop really is.
Yeah,
so,
that sounds bad.
Yeah, like literally, like just to show y'all that I'm not lying. I'm doing everything from my phone.
That's crazy.
So, yeah. So if you would like to donate to me to help me get a new laptop, you know what I'm saying? That would be great. Y'all can hit me up, $ Scoots Bronson on Cash App. You know what I mean? If y'all really, you know what I'm saying, care about the pod and want to see it thrive, then you know what I'm saying, that would be something to do, you know. S. Need a mic. Like, it's a lot of stuff we need. If y'all, you know what I'm saying? If y'all wanna help, you know what I'm saying? For sure, that would be great. But listen, man, hit us up. Can't wait. I'm tripping. Thank you guys so much for the support. We'll see y'all on the next episode. Until the next episode, man, like they say in Hollywood, that's a wrap.
Good. Okay.